Hi, good evening friends. Welcome to the session on Indian Evidence Act 1872. In the last session, we had discussed about relevancy of facts up to section 38, and 39 has already been replaced by Information Technology Act 2000. Today, we are going to discuss section 40, 41, 42 and 43. In this video, we will confine our discussion into section 40. Always remember three things, that is fact, fact in issue and relevant fact. Whenever you discuss anything pertaining to Indian Evidence Act 1872, these three things should come to your mind. Fact, what is a fact? A fact is something that can be perceived by your senses. Now, fact in issue is that fact which is already in dispute. These things have been already defined under section 3, that is interpretation clause. Fact means and includes anything, state of thing, relation of things capable of being perceived by our senses. We can see, we can feel, we can smell, or anything that can be perceived by our senses is a fact. Or any relation of things. Now this book belongs to me, I am the owner of this book. Is a relationship between them. Capable of being perceived by the senses, with our five senses, okay, sense organ. Similarly, any mental condition of which one person is conscious. Somebody is sane, somebody is insane, somebody is eccentric, somebody is lunatic, all those things are facts, fine. Now, what is fact, relevant fact? One fact is said to be relevant to another when the one is connected with the other in one of the ways referred to in the provisions of this act relating to relevancy of facts. That's very, very important. The relevant fact is, one fact is said to be relevant to another, when one is so connected with the other in any of the ways referred to in the provisions of this act, that is from section 5 to 55, Indian Evidence Act has very clearly laid down those things which are relevant and admissible in the court as evidence. That is called a relevant fact. Alright? Now, fact in issue means what? Any fact from which by itself or in connection with other facts, the existence or non-existence, nature or extent of right, liability, disability, asserted or denied in any suit or proceeding which necessarily follows. In simple language, I can say like this. Suppose this pen, that pen is a fact. Okay, I can see it, that this is pen. When I say this is my pen, Mr. Anil says, no, this is not your pen, this is my pen. Now this pen, which was earlier a fact, has now become a fact in issue. What is the issue? Whether this pen belongs to me, Mr. Nawaz, or whether this pen belongs to Mr. Anil. So that is the fact in issue. Now that has to be proved by means of relevant facts. What will be my relevant fact? I will produce my bill. I purchase from this shop. The shopkeeper will come and testify this, yes, I have given this pen, I sold this pen for rupees 50 and this is my bill. I can produce certain things. He will also maybe bringing something else. But what such facts can be brought in evidence? What all can be adduced in evidence? Only relevant facts can be adduced. So a fact in issue has to be proved by means of relevant facts. And where do we go for relevant facts? These relevant facts are very much specified from section 5 to 55. Alright? In this, some important sections have already been dealt with earlier, in the earlier sessions. Today, we are going to discuss section 40. What is section 40? Section 40 is previous judgments relevant to bar a second suit or trial. You see, as a general principle of law, any judgment, whether it is previous judgment or subsequent judgment, any judgment is not at all relevant for a subsequent proceeding. But there are some exceptions also. Now, how can you say that a judgment is not relevant to a subsequent proceeding? This can be explained by means of a very simple illustration. I am manufacturer of a cycle. Okay, I have got a factory where cycles are manufactured and selling out. Now, I sold a cycle to Mr. Anil. He, after 2-3 weeks, came to me, "Sir, your cycle is defective. I want to get it replaced." I said, "Sorry, I cannot do it." He initiated proceedings against me in a competent court. I also contested the case. Finally, the case was decided in my favor. The court said, "You don't have to give the compensation. The cycle was not defective." Okay, there ends the matter. Now, Mr. Sunil, after 6 months, purchased another cycle from me. Same thing happened. After 3 weeks, 2-3 weeks, he found that the cycle which I sold to him is defective. He came to me, I refused. Subsequently, he approached the court. Now, I just cannot go to the court with a previous judgment, which was issued by the court in my behalf, in my favor. I just cannot take that judgment which was issued by the court in the case between Nawaz versus Anil. In the case, I got a judgment in my favor. I cannot take this judgment and go to the court for Sunil's case and say, "My Lord or Your Honor, I have got a judgment already in my favor last week." That is not relevant. Common sensically and legally also, you can apply your mind that a case which has been decided between myself and Anil, maybe it is in my favor and judgment is with me, will not be applicable to Mr. Sunil. Alright? Because it was not a judgment in run, it was judgment in persona, between persons, only binding upon the persons. So, I think it is very clear now how a judgment doesn't become relevant. But there are certain cases, certain occasions when judgments become relevant. Have you heard of res judicata? Section 11. Section 11 of CPC deals with res judicata. A person cannot be vexed twice for the same offense. That means there is a maxim? Nemo debet bis vexari pro idem posa. That means no man ought to be troubled twice for one and the same cause. If a person has a judgment which bars a subsequent trial, so I have been convicted or I have been acquitted in a particular case. Now, for the same case, I cannot be tried again. There is a bar. And it is applicable in civil and criminal also. In criminal case, we say, "Autor fois acquit, autor fois convict." That means, a person who has been tried for an offense cannot be tried again for the same offense. There is a bar for the subsequent trial. That's all about section 40. That means, if there is a bar, if there is a judgment existing which bars a subsequent trial, then that judgment becomes relevant. The statute says like this: previous judgment relevant to bar a second sort of trial. The existence of any judgment, order or decree, it can mean anything, either a judgment, order or decree, which by law prevents any court from taking cognizance of a suit or holding a trial, is relevant fact. But the question is whether such court ought to take cognizance of such suit or hold such trial. Is that clear to you now? That means a judgment is already existing in that judgment you have been acquitted already. That means for the same course of action or for the same offense, you cannot be tried again. You cannot be tried again means there is a law which bars a subsequent trial, which bars a second trial, which bars again a trial for the same offense. So if there is a judgment which bars a subsequent trial, then that judgment is a relevant fact. You can adduce it. You can adduce it in evidence. You can produce it. That there is a, suppose I have been tried already, I have been acquitted. If somebody again going to the same court, approaches the same court and initiates proceedings against me, I can say, sir, in the same circumstances, in the same case, I have already been acquitted. So, this is denial of justice. So, I have got constitutional protection, I have got statutory protection. So, there was to be catalyzed invoked. But what should be the bar? The bar should be, the question is whether to take cognizance of the case again or not. Now, the court will decide, yes, this court has already decided this case. So, hence, we cannot further proceed. Case is dismissed. Case cannot be considered. This is section 40. In the upcoming video, we will discuss on section 41, 42 and 43. Thank you.